Welcome to Your Personality Tree with Florence Littauer. Author of many helpful books, including Personality Plus, Florence is well known for her Christian counsel and her insights into what makes relationships work. In this program, you'll learn about the person God intended you to be and about how your personality interacts with others. Let's join Florence in Your Personality Tree.
How many of you here tonight know at least one person that you could really shape up if they'd only listen to you? How many of you? At least one person. Isn't it amazing how all of us can be amateur psychiatrists? Each one of us can see all the things that are wrong with somebody else and know just what we could do about it. However, in this series, we're going to be looking at ourselves, because I've found out, and Fred's found out, after 15 years, when we each tried to shape up the other one to be wonderful like us, that it didn't work. As we tried that, we found out that the only person that we could do much about was ourselves. And we began to work. After 15 years of a declining marriage, we began to stop shaping up the other person, and we started shaping up ourselves. In the last few lessons that we've had, we've been looking at the different personalities. I'm going to review those for you because some of you may not have heard the other series, may not have been a part of this. Let's look and see what we've said so far. On our first lesson, I shared with you my life story. I taught you a principle. The principle was that opposites attract, that we fall in love with opposite strengths, and we go home to live with opposite weaknesses. Fred and I did that. We also found that after many years of an unsuccessful marriage, that we had two tragedies in our life, that we had two sons who were born without a complete brain, each one of them one after the other. One died at 2, one died at 19, was in an institution for all those years. And Fred and I found out what it was like to be depressed. In those days, we did not understand the different kinds of personalities. We didn't realize that people were different. I just thought if only Fred could be fun like me, we could get along just fine. And Fred thought if he could only get me on a chart and get me organized and pulled together, that he could be happy. Now, at this point, we found out two things. One, as we were sitting in depression with our two sons, both of us, one time after another, committed our lives to the Lord Jesus. And as we did this, and I personally on Romans 12:1-2, that said that what I was to do was to present my body, all of me, to the Lord. That I was to present my body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him, which is my reasonable service. That I was not to be conformed to the world, which is what I spent my whole life doing, but that I was to be transformed by the renewing of my mind. Transformed so that I could get rid of my depression, so that I could become what it was that God wanted me to be. So I wanted to be transformed by the renewing of my mind so that I would know what was that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God for me. I shared that with you, that that was the verse on which I prayed and asked that the Lord would take control of my life. After that, we did adopt a young son. So in our first lesson, I shared my life with you and reviewed those principles. Opposites attract, that we fall in love with opposite strengths, go home to live with opposite weaknesses, and that just because Fred is different doesn't make him wrong. Our second lesson, we looked at strengths carried to extremes become weaknesses. That's the principle we looked at then. And as we see our chart, the sanguine has tremendous strengths. They are the popular kind of person. They love to have a good time. They want to have fun. They can talk anywhere, on any subject, at any time, with or without information. The truth has never stood in the way of a good story for the sanguine. And I still feel that way today, even though I know these principles. I still feel today that if you tell me a story that's very boring, but it does have enough merit for me to pass it on to somebody else, that it would certainly be wrong of me to pass it on to you as boring as I heard it. Now, the sanguine can talk anywhere, on any subject at any time, with or without information, but carrying that to an extreme, they talk all the time. They become compulsive talkers. They interrupt everybody that's around. They don't let anyone say a word, and they think they're the only one that has some cute line to say. The cholerics are the powerful people. Where the sanguine is popular, the choleric is powerful. They are able to control anything. They can take charge. They can run it. They can show the dummies how to do it. They can handle everything correctly, and they don't think anybody else knows how to do a thing right. Because of that, when you carry that to an extreme, even though these leadership positions are certainly positive traits, that when you carry that to an extreme, they become bossy and arrogant, Take charge of everything and don't let anyone else make up any of their mind or any decisions whatsoever. Now, as we see this, these two people are both outgoing and optimistic. One loves to talk, one loves to work. One loves to have fun, one wants to be in control. Both of them have strength, but each one, when they're carried to extremes, these strengths become weaknesses. The other two, the more low-key people, the melancholy, their greatest strength is that they are deep, thoughtful, introspective, analytical, that they can organize anything. But carried to an extreme, they're organizing everything to such a detail that no one else can understand it. I had one lady say to me, "Pastor so-and-so is very deep." And I said, "How do you know he's so deep?" She said, "I've been going there for 6 months. I haven't understood a word he said yet." That's deep. So melancholy sometimes gets so deep and depressed that nobody really wants to be around them. The phlegmatic, they're peaceful, easygoing, don't want to cause any trouble, get along with anybody, all-purpose people. And as they get along with anybody, this is a great strength, but carried to an extreme, they become very passive, indecisive, unenthusiastic, unmotivated, and just don't get out of the chair and get moving. So in our second lesson, we looked at all the strengths, how when they're carried to extremes, they become weaknesses. We also looked at some of the political characters. We saw that President Nixon was a powerful. He was President Powerful. He came in on his strengths, another principle. They came in on their strengths, they left on their weaknesses. He came in on his strengths that he was powerful, in control. We wanted to end the Vietnam War. We wanted to get law and order. We wanted things to be done right. We wanted it to be done his way, and he was able to take control. He came in on his strengths, but then he reached for knowledge that was beyond what he needed. And in that, he left on his weaknesses. We then found that we had President Peaceful. President Peaceful came in, and that was Gerald Ford. He liked everybody, everybody liked him. He didn't have any great ideas, wasn't going anywhere, but he sat there and was happy to just hold things together. All we asked of him was that he keep peace, and that's what he did. So we had President Peaceful. Came in on his strengths, everybody loved him, left on his weaknesses, never got motivated out of the chair, and really ran. Therefore, he was defeated, and he was defeated by President Perfect. And this was Jimmy Carter. And Jimmy determined in his melancholy engineering mind that he was going to plan how to win. He and his wife, the Iron Magnolia, together, ran a campaign. He came in on his strengths. We wanted a person who was moral, who had high standards, who did everything correctly, who was right, who thought deeply, who was analytical. He came in on his strengths. But after 4 years, he left on his weaknesses. He told us what a depressing time we were all having. He said we were in a national malaise. And after we got so depressed for 4 years, we decided we wanted someone who would give us a party. So we then voted in President Popular. And if you do remember when Reagan and Carter had their debate, that Carter came in with all the facts. He knew all the melancholy details. He started asking them of Reagan, who knew none. And as he asked him all of these things, as he was asking him the details, sanguines don't need to know any of the answers. All they have to do is keep their charm up. And he just looked into the camera and he said, "There he goes again." And on that line, we voted him in. We thought any man that cute and funny ought to be president. So we put him in the White House, and his ability to laugh and have fun is what we liked. He's been called the Teflon president because he always smiles and tells a story no matter what the problems are, and nobody's able to stick anything on him. So we have had President Popular. If you remember, he can tell a story about everything. If you remember when he was shot, he was on his way to the operating room, and he looked up to the orderly pushing him down the aisle, and he said to him, "I do hope the surgeon is a Republican." Now, at the time that he was in there, with the bullet close to his heart, making funny stories, that you remember, since he was out of commission, that it was choleric powerful Alexander Haig that stepped in there, and he stood in front of the cameras, and he said, "I am in control." Now, that was interesting that he took control because he was not even the vice president. That didn't bother him at all. And poor old George was lost somewhere in the bushes. In our third lesson, we looked at the area of how to get along with difficult people. We found out that different people have different personalities, and that as we understand their strengths and their weaknesses, we can get along with just about anybody. It isn't that we have to have a certain person around us to enjoy life. It's that when we understand everybody's strengths and their weaknesses, we can then understand them. We can get along with just about anybody if we know their strengths and their weaknesses. We looked at that and we applied that area to pastors. Because everybody, every search committee that I talk to is looking for a pastor who has all of these strengths and no weaknesses. Now, the principle that we learned then was that Jesus is the only one that has all these strengths and none of the weaknesses, and yet many of us are looking for him to be pastor of our church. But when we become realistic, we find out that Pastor Popular is the one that is great in the pulpit. A lot of charisma, charm, magnetism, tells funny stories. People come from far and wide to hear him. He's so amusing. He's exciting on Sunday morning. But after a while, he can't keep track of the money. He doesn't know who it was that died last week. He shows up at the wrong funeral, if at all. Can't remember anybody's names, and he isn't very deep. So after a while, the people say, let's get a new pastor. What we need is a deep pastor. And so then we get Pastor Perfect. And as we get Pastor Perfect, he is deep. He studies in the Word. He brings in the Greek Bibles. He shows us all these things, and we get so impressed that we get almost depressed. And after a while of that, we say, let's get rid of Pastor Perfect, deep though he is, and let's get Pastor Powerful. Let's get this church on the move again. And so we get Pastor Powerful. He comes in, he takes charge of everybody, controls every single situation. And after a while, he does well until he meets somebody that disagrees with him. And since the only right way is his way, and if you don't agree with that, one of you has to leave. So pretty soon, Pastor Powerful has a split in the church, packs up his little group, goes down the street and starts a new one. Now, with the rift in the church, we then turn to Pastor Peaceful, because we want a person who will heal all of our wounds. And as he heals the wounds, as he lets us relax and take it easy in church, we're so happy for a while. But after a while, we begin to say, my, this is dull. Couldn't we get back Pastor Popular? And this is what many of our churches are doing, shifting around, trying in vain to find out that person who will be perfect. So we've looked that there is no perfect person. But when we understand their strengths and their weaknesses, we can get along with just about anybody. Our fourth lesson was on the area of emotional needs. We began to look to find out why it is that each one of us, those of us that are married, can't seem to meet the needs of that other person. We somehow don't know what it is they want. And we tend to give them what we want because we figure if we give it to them enough, they'll give it back to us. But unfortunately, most of them are too dumb to do that. And they don't give us back what it is we want. And we find out that we have an impasse in our marriage. But what we have found, as Fred and I have worked with this, is that each one of us, according to our personality, has a different set of emotional needs. That the sanguine person wants to have attention, they want approval, and they want acceptance just as they are. The choleric person wants appreciation. They want people to notice all the good works they have done. Both of these get their sense of self-worth from outside of themselves, from other people. This one in compliments about how wonderful they are, this one in praise on all the works that they've accomplished. So their self-worth is dependent upon what other people say to them and how they respond. These two have a self-worth that comes from within them, that where they have different needs, the melancholy, the perfect person, they want to have people who will get inside and be sensitive to their needs, who will have a sense of order and who will give them a little space. They also need to feel that somehow they are always right because they're perfect. The phlegmatic also has an inner need to have people feel that they are of value, that they are of worth, that they're really going to amount to something. Now, as we look at these two get their sense of worth from inside. These two get it from outside. Now, as we look at these four different people, we're using this as our basis that we may be able to find out tonight how to know who I am so I can understand my needs, how to understand you by knowing your strengths and weaknesses so we can get along together, so that there's no way that I can look at you and think that you're out to get me. And that's what I used to feel about Fred. I thought, Fred is out to get me. But after a while, I found out that his withdrawal and his depression was because I was coming on too strong. And the stronger I came on, the more Fred pulled away. And we began to learn the value of understanding our different personalities. We're studying this not so that we will be able at any time to pin labels on other people, but we're studying this so that we will be able to analyze ourselves, look at our strengths and our weaknesses, so that we can emphasize our strengths and work humanly and prayerfully to overcome our weaknesses.
I wish it were true that I had never tried to change Florence. But unfortunately, that is not the truth. I spent many years trying to shape her up, trying to make her the wife that I thought she ought to be. But the understanding of this concept, understanding that we are different and that different does not make us wrong, has helped tremendously. And when we couple that with the truths that God has given us in His Scripture, we have a perfect formula for happy living, for a happy, harmonious marriage. There are three verses that I'd like to share with you, and I'd like for you to make notes of them, that are not verses particularly on marriage, but have really helped us and tie in so beautifully with what Florence has been sharing. The first one is Romans 12:10. That is a verse that God has been speaking to me about a great deal lately. And just in very simple terms, that verse says, in honor, preferring one another.
That means that I am to put Florence in first place, that I am to rejoice when Florence is honored, that I am to think of her first. Many times people ask me, how do you handle it when Florence is standing up there getting all the praise, all the recognition? Doesn't that bother you? And I am honestly able to say, no, it doesn't. You know why? Because in honor, I prefer her. I rejoice when you applaud for Florence. I rejoice when her words, her testimony, the message that God has given is touching other lives. In honor, preferring one another, putting the other one in first place. Another hard lesson that I had to learn is Romans 15:7. Wherefore, accept one another, even as God has accepted you. Accept one another. Had I accepted Florence? No, I hadn't. You see, I was trying to change her. God gave Florence a certain birth personality, and I was trying to change that personality. God is well pleased with what he created in Florence. And I think he was well pleased with what he created in me, too. At least I hope so. But I know he was pleased with Florence. And it wasn't my job to try to change her. And I have personalized my Bible to say, accept Florence, even as God has accepted her, for Christ's sake. That's our job, to accept one another, not to try to change each other. That's Romans 15:7. Another verse that I dearly love and has helped me so tremendously is Philippians 2, verse 3. And that one says, regard the other as more important than yourself. Now think of that for a moment. Regard the other as more important than yourself. And I too have personalized that in my scripture. It says, regard Florence as more important than myself. That means that any time that I would be apt to get upset with Florence because she hadn't said something, she hadn't done something, she hadn't responded, she hadn't reacted the way I would have liked her to, she wasn't meeting my emotional needs, I'm to regard her as more important than myself. What does that mean? That means that I am to meet her needs, not worry about whether she is meeting my needs. Three verses, but they have given me God's insight as to how we are to relate one another. No longer am I trying to change Florence. I am accepting her just the way she is. And I hope you're beginning to understand that God wants you to do that also. And this concept gives you the ability to do that. That gives you an understanding that God created us with different personalities and opposites attract. Now, what are you going to do with all this knowledge, all this information, this wonderful tool that Florence has been sharing with you? I hope by now that each one of you has completed your personality profile and has completed your scoring sheet so that you have an idea of what your personality is. One of the things that you learned in doing your personality profile is that you have strengths. Wasn't that wonderful? Wasn't it fun to do the top half? How did you enjoy the bottom half? A lot of you are shaking your heads. No, that isn't a lot of fun. The cholerics don't even bother with the bottom half because they're all right. They have no weaknesses. But as I mentioned to you, if you have trouble finding your weaknesses, ask your partner. They'll help you. Now, I would challenge you, therefore, tonight, before this day is over, that you select two of the weaknesses that you have described yourself as having. Two out of the 20. Now, if you have any trouble choosing them, ask your partner again. He or she will help you. But what I would challenge you to do is to prayerfully ask the Lord to strengthen you in those areas of weakness. Psalm 139 says, search me, O God. Try me and know my heart. If there be any offensive way in me, lead me in the way everlasting. This little simple profile will help you to understand some of those ways in your nature, in your personality, that might be offensive to the people you live with, to the ones you work with. And I would challenge you tonight to ask the Lord to help you overcome those weakness areas, help you to be strengthened so that what? So that you might become more like the Lord Jesus himself, so that you might be a living witness of the power of the Lord in your life. Pray specifically, daily, and then ask your partner to help you to overcome those two areas of weakness, and God will change your relationship with other people in a way that you never believed was possible.
As we're looking at our charts, if you have taken your personality profile and you've come out to be half sanguine and half choleric, the popular type who is very powerful, this means that you want to be in charge of everything and everybody should do it your way, but you're going to have fun doing it. If you are this combination, it means that you want to be in charge and have everybody do it your way, but it should be perfect. So either you want to have it your way and fun, or your way and perfect. Now, if you're this combination, you want everything to be perfect, but not if it'll cause any troubles, because the phlegmatic does not want to have any conflict or any problems. And if you're this combination, the sanguine and the phlegmatic, the peaceful and the popular, that means that you'd like to have fun, but not if you need to go somewhere to do it. Now, should you have come out with half of these two that are opposite, or half of these two that are opposite, that probably means that somewhere in your past you have put on a mask, that you've covered up the birth personality that God gave you, and somehow, because of adverse circumstances, you've put another mask over the real self, and you somehow throughout the years have been playing a part that wasn't genuine and that wasn't real. As I find people with these, we have come up with four different kinds of masks. The first one, the sanguine mask, is the mask that someone puts on when they want to have fun. Usually we find that they put the masks on in childhood, in teenage years, or sometimes when they get married. Let's say, for example, that I had one lady who came to me and she said, I realize that I am half sanguine, half melancholy. I know there's something wrong with that. What could it be? We began to look at her childhood, and she came up with the fact that her mother had been sick. Her father had told her every day when he went to work, you go in there and cheer up your mother. Now, this girl was basically a melancholy. Her father said, go in there and cheer up your mother. Do funny things for her. Put on little skits. Amuse her all day. She needs to have some fun. She's very depressed. She's very unhappy. Go and amuse your mother. So the little melancholy girl who had no interest in amusing her mother, who didn't know any cute and funny stories, tried her very best to become like her sister Sally, who seemed to always have it together, who seemed to always be having fun and telling cute things. And so the little melancholy girl tried to become like sister Sally, tried to be amusing for her mother, put on a sanguine mask of the clown, the sanguine mask of trying to be popular when it wasn't her at all. I had another girl that came in, and she had that same combination, but instead of being a melancholy wearing a sanguine mask, she was a sanguine girl who'd married a man that had almost killed her, emotionally speaking. He had tried very hard to bring her over here and to make her melancholy like him. And remember our principle that we need to keep our people functioning in their strengths, not pulling them over to function in their weaknesses. And this man had pulled her over so that what she was not a sanguine melancholy, but she was a sanguine who was depressed. Sometimes I find that there are people in childhood that have been abused, sexually molested. I have a chapter in Personality Tree that talks about the bruised fruit. And the bruised fruit are those of us who had some problem in childhood, some kind of a trauma or molestation that made us put on the melancholy mask of pain. So that as we grew up, we weren't really sure who we were, but we knew that something hurt inside. A little black cloud traveled everywhere with us, the melancholy mask of pain. The choleric mask is that mask of power. I'm going to take control. I'll be in charge. One young man came to me, and he came out half of each of these, which is not a natural combination. As I talked with him, he told me that he had an alcoholic mother, that every day she was lying on the couch, she was unable to function. And I find that most of the time when there's an alcoholic mother, the father either does not come home because he doesn't want to see her, or he comes home and joins her in the drinking, one or the other. In either case, there's an absentee father, one who does not function in his proper role. This young man told me that he had really been a very peaceful child. He didn't want any confrontation. He didn't want to get in any troubles. But he said one day he looked around. He saw his mother lying there. He saw the sister there wanting something to eat. And he said to himself, somebody's got to take charge of this place. And he put on that choleric mask, that mask of power, forced his peace-loving little personality to become a choleric. And when I talked to him, he didn't know which he was. He was half of each. But really what we had was a peaceful man, a phlegmatic man, who'd been playing choleric, playing powerful, because he needed to do that because of the adversities of life. The phlegmatic mask is the mask of peace. That's the mask that we put on, especially cholerics, put this on when they find out that they can't get their own way. If they're not going to win, cholerics won't play at all. So sometimes they find out there's no point in entering, I'm not going to win. They decide they'll back up and they'll just take it easy. They put on the phlegmatic mask of peace. Now, as we look at these quickly tonight, you want to ask yourself, you want to say to yourself, which one am I? Am I genuinely a sanguine, or am I wearing that mask of the clown, that mask of popularity, trying to be cute and funny? Am I really a choleric? Was I born that way to be in charge? Do I instinctively step forward whenever there's an emergency? Do I move ahead and grab whatever needs to be done and take care of it? Am I really a choleric? Or am I someone who's had to be in charge when I didn't even want to do it? Am I really a melancholy, deep and thoughtful and introspective? Do I really like to have all the spices alphabetized in the cabinet? Do I want to do that? or have I put on this perfect mask and I'm trying to be that perfect person to please someone else? Or am I really a peace-loving phlegmatic? Or have I just put on a mask? Later on, we'll show you at another time the mask that I put on, that Fred put on, that his mother put on. We'll show you the mask in our family. But ask yourself tonight, what kind of a mask is it that you're wearing? Because if you're wearing a mask today, it's time for you to find out what you were intended to be, what God wanted you to be, and take the mask off for good. Let me share one story with you about how to analyze and use all of these different terms in your own family. As I'm sharing with you, I would like you to think about your Christmas. Christmas at our house, this is what we have. We have choleric daughter Lauren, who is in charge. We have the meal at her house because she's the one who chooses where we will have the meal. She tells every one of us what we're going to bring, what we're going to do, and what time we're going to come. Lauren is in charge. Now Fred gets the whole day organized. He gets out his yellow legal pad and he organizes Christmas Day lest we have any fun. He makes columns, and Fred has Christmas rules. He has rules that say only one person opens a gift at a time, that we have to rotate so that some person does not get two in a row, and then for my mother's sake, we had the extra rule of that we must save the paper because who knows if we can afford any next year. So as we sit there on Christmas Day, we have Collard Lauren in charge. Fred is keeping all of the charts and making sure he gives down on the paper who gives a gift to what person so that we can always be sure we get a thank you note, and he checks it off on that column later. Now this particular Christmas that I'm thinking about, my little phlegmatic mother was sitting there on the couch, and she was between choleric Lauren on one side and her choleric sister, my Aunt Jean, on the other. Aunt Jean had brought a gift out from Connecticut for mother. It had come from her friends at Gift Shop, the group that my mother used to go to every single week when she was in Massachusetts, where they crocheted little covers for rolls of toilet paper. And they made little Christmas trees out of old empty tuna fish cans. And mother used to go to that every week and love that. And so when she came out to live out here with us, Aunt Jean came out and brought her a present. So here they were sitting this particular Christmas. Aunt Jean hands her this box and she says, "Here, open this. This is from your friends at Gift Shop." Now, cholerics don't necessarily speak graciously. And she handed this box to my mother. My mother opened it up, she pulled it out, and inside the box was a little unbleached muslin apron with red bias binding around the edge. Aunt Jean said to her, "That is an apron." Cholerics somehow feel that phlegmatics don't know an apron when they see one. She pointed out it's an apron. She says, "You will notice there is writing all over that. All of that writing right there. See those writing? That's all the names of your friends at Gift Shop. They have written their names all over that. So when you wear that apron, that you will be able to think, look down, see all those names, and think of your friends at Gift Shop." Now, after Aunt Jean gave this choleric speech, my mother held the apron up, looked over all the names. She said, "That's nice." She started folding it up. She said, "I will not wear this apron." Now, Aunt Jean looked at her and said, "What do you mean? You won't wear that apron? You will wear that apron. You will wear that apron. Do you think I'm going back to your friends at Gift Shop and tell them after all the trouble they put into making this apron that you will not wear it? You will wear that apron." Lauren's on the other side. She said, "You will wear that apron. You will wear it today. You will wear it right after dinner. You will wear the apron." Mother folds it up. She says, "This is just too good to use." Folds it up, puts it in the box, put it down on the floor, and she just looked up at us and she said, "I will not wear this apron." Now, I thought that was such a wonderful story that a month later, when I was speaking in Dallas, I had my mother with me, and I thought, I'd like to tell that little Christmas story. I looked down, my mother was in the front row, and I thought, do I dare tell a story while she's here? And then I thought, well, she's 85. How much time has she got to hate me? I told the story, and when I got to the end of that story, I looked down to see my mother's reaction. My mother stood right up, turned around to the crowd, and in a very uncustomary way, she looked at the crowd, and she said, "And I didn't." In the Bible, in Proverbs 22:6, it tells us that we are to train up a child in the way he should go. And then when he's old, he won't depart from it. Now that's great advice. It's good for us as parents and as grandparents to realize that each child has a separate personality. But it's very hard for us to train them up in the way they should go if we have nothing to measure them by, no yardstick by which we may see what kind of personality they have. So what we've been doing in our last few lessons together is learning a tool, learning a measuring stick by which we may see which our child is, which one of these personalities that they represent. In Proverbs, as it tells us in 22:6, training up a child, so often that verse is used to comfort mothers with teenagers that are difficult. And we say, if you only train them up right, sooner or later they're going to shape up. Now, that's not necessarily true. But if we understand their personalities and know that the little sanguine child is one who wants to talk all the time, that they want to have attention and approval, and that if we can play with them and give them some life and some humor and let life be exciting and enjoyable for them, and if we can discipline them by approval, telling them how wonderful they are and never giving them, this is no good, you aren't going to amount to anything, what's the matter with you, why aren't you like your sister? Anytime we do any of those things, we depress a little sanguine. And a depressed sanguine never gets anything done at all. One that's not depressed doesn't do much, but one that is depressed will never get anything done at all. As we have a little choleric child, we learn that that child is very powerful, wants to be in control, wants to be doing something. As I raised Lauren, I can remember when she was standing up in her crib at about 6 or 8 months old, and she held onto the bars, looked through, and I could tell she was saying, how long before I can take this entire house away from Mother? The choleric child wants to be in control, and we need to give them something to control. Now, the thing that it should be is not me. In other words, we don't want to give the choleric child control of their parents, but they have to have something to control. I had one lady one time, she told me after coming to one of the seminars, she said, I realize now that I'm choleric and my son is choleric. She said, every single day, he changes all the furniture in his room, and when he goes to school, I change it all back again. And I said, why do you change it? She said, because the decorator told me where it was supposed to be. So I fix it that way every morning. But when he comes home from school, he moves it all the way he wants it to be. Now here is a couple, a mother and a child, both of them powerful, both of them in control, and each one of them playing Mayflower moving van every day. Now when you look at that, you realize that there's something wrong there. And a child has to have something to control, especially a choleric child. They need something that they can be in charge of. So be sure that they have something, their room, half the garage, the backyard, a dog, or something. But they've got to have something to control, because if they don't, they'll go out and they'll have problems with their peers. The melancholy child needs to have a place to call his own, pull himself away from the crowd, be able to get by himself, keep things in order, have his place set so that he can reach what he wants and that he has all life under his control. He wants things to be perfect and to be right. Don't put him rooming with a sanguine child, because if you put the two of them together, no matter what their age is, they will have problems. We had a lady come up to us one day after we had been doing a seminar like this, and she came up and said, I have twins, and one of them is sanguine, and one of them is melancholy. Now you can picture this. Now that we know these terms, now that we know how to understand and evaluate using these, picture that you've got 12-year-old twins, a little sanguine boy, and a little melancholy boy. Now the situation was, the parents, the mother, choleric melancholy, the father, phlegmatic melancholy. So what have we got out of four people here? We have, what, three melancholies. We've got three here that are melancholy. So which one of these twins is going to be the one that's going to fit in well in this family? Which one? The melancholy. Because he did the right thing at the right time, he always behaved well, did his homework exactly the way he was supposed to do it, gave nobody any trouble. In school, all of his teachers would say to this little boy, why can't you be perfect like your brother? Why can't you be smart like your brother? Why can't you pass your work in on time, like your brother? Now, after a while, when they lived together in the same room, went to the same school, same church, same Sunday school, same teachers, year after year, this one was being praised because he did everything right, and this one had the feeling that he wasn't worth a thing. One day, as the mother told me, that she came home, and he had just taken everything in the room and pulled it down. The drapes were off the wall, pulled right out. He had emptied out all the drawers. He had thrown everything in the room around, and when his mother walked in and screamed, he threw it to the ground and sat on top of her. Now, she called the paramedics. They took him off to a mental hospital. And when she shared this with me, the boy was, at that time, in a mental hospital. Now, was this boy really a mental case? No, he was a boy whose parents had no understanding, didn't know any idea why he wasn't like the rest of them. Why was he different? And as the mother told me, he's really always been a peculiar child. Now, you see, this mother was not trying to train up the child in the way he should go. She didn't have any guidelines by which to do that. She was training him up in the way his brother should go. And she was trying to make him exactly like his brother. And as I talked with her, I said, does he have a melancholy psychiatrist? I found out that most psychiatrists are melancholy. I mean, who else but a melancholy would want to spend all those years training to sit around and listen to people with gloomy thoughts day after day? I've found as I talk to doctors, and I frequently do some doctors' seminars, some medical groups, I've found out that the doctors who are sanguine usually end up being pediatricians so they can play with the children. The cholerics are running all the wings and all the different hospitals. They're in charge of everything, telling all the rest of them what to do. The melancholies are surgeons. Now, when you think about it, would you want a sanguine operating on your brain? Can you just picture that the sanguine doctor would open up your brain and say, my, what is that? I see, we want to be sure that we have somebody who knows what he's doing when he starts to cut us up. And I've also found from experience that most of the phlegmatic doctors are anesthetists. They just have to stand there and hold the thing and wait. Now, as I talked with this lady about the psychiatrist, I said, is he melancholy? She said, yes, he is. I said, what's he doing to help the boy? She said, well, he's given him a chart and a list, and he's going to have to check it off every day so that he can get his life in order. Now, this was not a funny story because this was true. This is what was happening at that time. I said, do you have any sanguines in the family that are normal? Now, that's always a good question to ask on sanguines. Are there any normal sanguines in the family? She said, yes, I have this dingy sister. I said, well, it would be good if you could get the boy out of the hospital and send him to live with your sister for a while, because what is it this child needs more than a melancholy psychiatrist? What's he need to find out? That being sanguine is all right. That there are some people that are like him and that are normal. That's what he needs to learn. So it does tell us in Scripture that that's what we are to do, to raise up a child in the way he should go. As I have grandchildren now, I find it so much fun to be able to observe them. Right from the time little Randy was crawling around, he was melancholy. We knew right in the beginning he was melancholy. My adopted son is melancholy. When we went to pick him up from the adoption agency, the person handing him over to me said, she's from the minute that he has been here, he lies in that crib. He looks out as if he's analyzing all the rest of us. Now, he was melancholy at the start, and he is still melancholy. And little Randy, my grandson, very melancholy. He was crawling around with little matchbox cars and lining them up on the cracks in the tile floor in the foyer. Everything was done in order. And Lauren's second one, he is a sanguine choleric and a lot of fun. And as I have watched these children, it's been fun for me to see the difference. I took little Randy one day to Carl's Jr.'s. We were sitting there having a hamburger, and little deep Randy was looking at his hamburger, took the top of the roll off, and he stared down. He stared for a while, and then he looked up to me, and he said, Grammy, you know what I hate about this place? Now, I hadn't asked him, did he hate anything? I just want to have fun. I thought I was a noble grandmother to take him out to eat. And I certainly didn't want to sit around and describe why he hated the place I had taken him. So I looked at him and I thought, well, I better ask him. I said, what is it you hate about this place? He said, look, they don't even center the hamburger on the roll. Now, see, that's melancholy. That's a little melancholy child. And as I was talking to him, I said, Randy, there are some restaurants that if you knew what went on in the back room, you wouldn't even eat what it is they're giving you. He looked at me, said, Grammy, this place is one of those. He then said to me, Jonathan is such a pest. He said, Jonathan takes all my toys away from me. He takes the batteries out of my toys so I never know where they are. He breaks all my pencils. He said, it's so terrible to have a little brother. Then he looked up and he sighed, as little melancholies do. And he said to me, Grammy, the only good thing about having that new little brother is that now Jonathan is going to find out what it's like to have a little brother wrecking all his things. Now, he said that with a good feeling of vengeance thrown in. Then all of a sudden, this panic came over him, and he looked up and he said to me, you know what I just thought of, Grammy? And I said, what? He said, if Jonathan's got a little brother, that means that I've got two of them. And I almost died at that, at the very thought that he was going to have two little brothers. Now, as I observed little Randy and talked with him, I found and can see every day that I look at him that this is a melancholy, deep, thoughtful, introspective, analytical. He loves math. He loves to do everything that the teacher assigns him. Now, little Jonathan is different. Jonathan is sanguine. He loves to have fun. He enjoys a good time. They both have the same parents. They both live in the same home. They both go through the same sets of circumstances, but they see everything in life from a different point of view. I can remember one day when I called up and little Randy said to me on the phone, Grammy, have you heard the bad news? Now, see, melancholies always like to start right off with something deep and bad. So I said, no, Randy, I haven't heard the bad news. He said, Ginger the hamster is dead. That touched my heart. And I said, tell me about it, Randy. So Randy began to tell me. He said, Grammy, I went into her cage, and there she was lying, keeled over dead. And I said, I'm so sorry, Randy. He said, well, we had a funeral. Says, my daddy and I went out in the garage, and he told us all so melancholy. See, we went out in the garage and we found an old shoebox and we put paper towels in the bottom. We wrapped Ginger up in some tissue paper left over from Christmas. We put the cover on, taped it shut. We went out over the backyard down the hill, dug a hole, put her in, put dirt over her, and we had a little funeral. My daddy said some prayers, and that's the end of Ginger. Does that kind of get to you? I felt really gripped by this thing. So I listened to this whole tale, and when he was all through, I said to him, let me talk to Jonathan. So now I get Jonathan, little sanguine, choleric Jonathan, get him on the phone, and I said, Jonathan, I hear that Ginger the hamster is dead. I said it as deeply and sorrowfully as I could possibly muster up. I said, I hear that she is dead. And little Jonathan says, yep, she's dead, all right. I said, did you have a funeral? He said, no, we didn't have any funeral. We just threw in an old shoebox, stuck her in a hole in the ground, threw some dirt over her, and that's the end of Ginger. I said, are you going to get another hamster later? He says, well, I'll tell you one thing, Grammy. If we get another hamster and that one dies, it's bye-bye hamsters. Now, you realize we've got two little boys. They've got the same mother and father. They've got the same set of circumstances. They have the same hamster, and they went to the same funeral. But each one of them sees that from a very different point of view. Now, as we look at this, Lauren is going to share an example that just happened last week. She just told me yesterday. I asked her if she'd share this with me.
My sons were playing soccer this last weekend, and my older son, Randy Jr., played the very best soccer game he had ever played. He scored 2 goals in his right center position, played the game beautifully, the best game ever. And at halftime, the team was defeating the other team by such a score that the coach moved my son back to fullback so that we wouldn't score any more on the opponent. And so the second half of the game, he never even kicked the ball, and he walked off the field so depressed. Bear in mind, the best game this child's ever played in soccer. He walks off with this sad face and said, I might as well not even have played. I never got to kick the ball. In contrast, my Jonathan played one of his poorer games that very same Saturday. He even kicked the ball to the opponent's goal several times. The throw-ins were going in the opposite direction. And as he walked off the field, he said, "Wasn't I great?"
It is amazing how little children, from the time they're very young, are different. Same parents, same set of circumstances, but different kinds of reactions. Recently, the University of Minnesota completed a study called Twins Reared Apart. They gathered together 348 sets of twins, 44 of whom were identical twins. They found out that these were twins that had been separated at birth, adopted into different families, who had never seen each other and knew nothing about the other person. They'd done the research and pulled them all together. In the articles about this, and I have many different articles, more proof that we inherit our personality traits, twins raised apart offer new insights on heredity and environment, genes and behavior, a twin legacy, many other articles on this particular subject. One of them showed some pictures, and right here in the bottom it has a pair, some men in their 50s. They had not seen each other since they had been separated at birth. They didn't even know the other one existed. And yet when they came back together, when this study brought them back to the University of Minnesota, they arrived driving the same model blue Chevrolet. Each one of them chain-smoked Salem cigarettes. Each one bit his fingernails in the same way. Each one had a dog named Toy, and they both vacationed in Florida on the same strip of beach during the same time of the year every year. Now, that's more than coincidence. There are so many different stories that are given here, and all of it goes to prove basically one thing, and that one thing is that we do inherit our personalities. They checked it in 4 different areas. They checked on imagination and fun, creativity. They checked it in leadership, in high moral standards, and in adaptability. Those were the 4 areas, although they didn't label them this. And I have found that almost every personality test somehow goes back to the original, sanguine, choleric, melancholy, and phlegmatic. In the very back of Personality Tree, I have a chart that I put in there that compares these terms, the original terms for personalities. It compares them with all of the current personality tests so that you can see how they relate. And as I've studied it, I've found out that all the different ways that people divide up personalities ultimately go back to the original, the sanguine, the choleric, the melancholy, and the phlegmatic. Now, as we look at these today and look at the area of children, ask yourself, what are your children like? And are you raising them according to what God's Word says? Are you raising them by training them up in the way that they should go versus the way that you have dreamed up? My brother was a chaplain in the Air Force, and while he was in the Air Force, he was stationed at the Air Force Academy for a few years. During that particular time, he called me one evening to tell me this story about a young boy. This boy, even though my brother did not use these terms, this boy was a melancholy. He was artistic, he played the piano, he was musical. He was a fine boy, very high standards, deeply intellectual, but totally out of place in the Air Force Academy. He didn't like anything to do with the physical attributes of this. He hated war, he didn't like the military, and he didn't want to be there. Now, when you add all that up together, you would ask the same question my brother asked him, then what are you doing here? And he said, I'm here because my colonel father, an obvious choleric, brought me up from the time I was little, handing me guns and telling me, you will be in the Air Force. You will be a colonel like your father. In fact, if you really work at it, you should be a general. He said, my father was telling me from the time I could toddle that I was going to be in the Air Force. He said, I never wanted to be. I didn't apply for it. My father got the forms, had his friends fill out the references. He sent it all in. I just dutifully signed my name, and here I am at the Air Force Academy. So my brother, in counseling with him and talking with him, decided that he definitely didn't belong there. So my brother, who was also a full colonel, wrote a letter to the father and told him, I don't think your son belongs here. I think you should take him out and put him in a liberal arts college. Now, you, from what you already know, each one of you think, if we have a melancholy boy who doesn't like war and doesn't want to be in the Air Force, and he goes home with a letter from the chaplain to the choleric colonel father, who has determined from the time the boy was born that he would be the same thing, and who does not understand in any way the different kinds of personalities, and assumes that everybody should be powerful like him and do it his way. Now, what is the reaction when the boy comes home with this letter and gives it to his father? Can you imagine? What are some of the things the father probably said? Anything. What?
Wimp.
You're a wimp. That's exactly, he did say that. You're a wimp. You're no good. What's the matter with you? Haven't I brought you up right? What does this chaplain know anyway? Why is he trying to interfere with our particular family life? Why don't you go back and tell him off? You will go back. You will march back. You will become a colonel in the Air Force. You will do it my way. I have decided this. And then he ended up by saying, and what would my friends think if they found out that my son couldn't make it? Now, those are some of the things that the father said to the boy. So when he came back, he came to my brother and he shared with him what his father had said. And he said, so I guess I have to stay here, even though I know it's the wrong place. When my brother called me up, that boy had just shot his head off in his room. He had committed suicide. Now, I'm sure the father did not think that any of that problem was his. He probably passed it off by saying, my son was just a weakling from the beginning. I never should have had such a son. I'm sure it was some kind of a mistake. They probably got mixed up in the hospital. I'm sure I would have had a different son from that. But I doubt that he ever understood the problem. When you think about your children, are you trying to make them into what you want them to be? Or are you doing what God's Word says? Train up that child in the way that he should go. I've tried to bring up my children with the understanding of the different kinds of personalities. Each time when Lauren or Marita would be bringing home a date, I would share with them that, tell me, what kind of a personality is this person? I can remember that Lauren dated a young man for about 3 years. His name was Steve, and Steve was very phlegmatic. Steve never really said anything in 3 years. You have to realize that with the phlegmatic, that everything is measured in how much energy it takes. So Steve didn't talk. That when Steve came in the door, and I would say, hi, Steve, and Steve would just stand there and go, now that meant hello from Steve. So year after year, I'd say, hi, Steve, and he'd go, like this. Now, Steve was phlegmatic, and I understood. As I raised my children, I tried to make sure that they understood their own personalities and their brothers and sisters. And I remember the day that Fred said to me one day, he said, Mother, I can't stand Marita any longer. I said, what do you mean? And he said, well, she's such a mess. Now, Marita's a sanguine with a little choleric, and he's melancholy. He wanted everything neat and orderly. And I said, what's the matter with Marita? He said, every time she walks through a room, things jump off the counters right onto the floor and smash. He said, Marita's car, have you ever seen it? said it looks like a trash can on wheels. As we discussed this, I said, Fred, do you know why God gave you Marita for a sister? Well, he didn't want to blame that on God. And then he said, no. And I said, well, it's because God knows that you as a melancholy are going to marry somebody just like your sister. And he's giving you some practice. He's letting you practice with Marita so that when you marry a girl just like her, you'll know how to get along with her. Now, that put him into an instant depression. He went off to school and he came back a couple of weeks later and he walked in one day and he said, Mother, you're right. And I wasn't sure what I was right about, but some of us mothers would give anything just to hear that from a child. Mother, you're right. So I said, what am I right about? He said, you're right about Marita. And I'd totally forgotten about my conversation with Marita. He said, you're right about Marita, that all the girls I like in school are just like Marita. From that time on, Fred was nicer to Marita. And we found out after a while, Marita said, what's wrong with Fred? I said, what do you mean? She said, he's being nice to me. I said, well, it's because I told him he's going to marry somebody like you and he's practicing on you. After a while, he came to me one day and he said, Mother, Marita has become my very best friend. Isn't it amazing when we understand these personalities that we can accept people just as they are? Later, I took my son to Europe. And as I was getting ready to take him to Europe, I prayed and I said, Lord, please give me the ability to treat him as he wants to be treated. Not to try to make him do things like me. Because if I took Lauren to Europe, we would be charging around, moving up and down every street, looking at every castle we could find. If I took Marita, we'd be laughing away, having a great time. But if I take Fred, it may be silent. We may just sit there on the bus for a while. I can remember one day when I said, come on, Fred, we're going to go see one more cathedral. Fred said, I don't want to see another cathedral. I said, Fred, this is what I would have said. I would say, Fred, I didn't ask you if you wanted to see a cathedral. I told you you were going to see a cathedral. Don't you realize how much money it cost me to bring you to Europe? Don't you realize that the more cathedrals that you see, the cheaper it is per capita, per cathedral for me? Now, he didn't seem to understand that, and so I didn't say that. I just thought about it, and I kept quiet. And I said, all right, Fred, you can just stay on the bus, and you can just wait. As we went through Europe, I had a girl following me. She followed me and took pictures of me in ungainly positions. Every time I would lean over a water cooler, she'd get a picture of me from the rear. After a while, one day she said to me, your son really loves you. Now, I had hopes that this deep, thoughtful, introspective, analytical melancholy had sat around and come up with the great glories of his mother. I'd hoped that he'd maybe sat down with her and told her how wonderful I was and what a great blessing it was to him in his life that he had me for a mother. So I said to her, tell me, what did he say? So she started to tell me, and I was waiting for this wonderful and great speech that was going to really excite my life. And she said to me, yesterday, you fell asleep on the bus. Your head was over against the window, and I looked over and I saw you that way, and I thought, what a great funny picture that'll be. So I took my camera and I posed it right on you, and just as I was about to take the picture, your son moved his whole body right in front of you. And I looked at him and I said, what are you trying to do? And he said to me, what are you trying to do? She said, I'm going to take a picture of your mother in that funny position. And she said, he looked right at me and he said, from here on, you will take no more pictures of my mother without her permission first. Then she looked at me and said, he really loves you. Now, that wasn't exactly what I'd expected. However, I was so glad to find out that even though we have different personalities, even though we have not always seen eye to eye, that I learned that when the chips are down, my boy is on my side.